Hey, everybody. It's been a long hiatus here, but welcome back to Words with Dani. I'm Emily Moyer from Off Planet Radio, and Dani is here. And we've had an unexpectedly long break because of just life. But we're glad to be back, and we have a bunch of topics to roll through tonight. So, Dani Katz, good to talk to you. What's going on?
Hi, Emily. Nice to see you.
Always nice to see you.
So we're going back into the matrix.
we like the pocket universe, and that's ultimately where we want to end up, but it's just not quite there yet. So we will return to the matrix and take a little visit to the pocket universe at the end. Yes.
Okay. So I forgot to tell you my crazy Facebook story as well. So okay. I'll bookmark that because that's sort of what launches the first topic, which is Marianne Williamson's bid for the presidency, which I don't like. That part is neither here nor there as far as this particular story.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Some people in this audience may not have any idea who Marianne Williamson is. So can you just give a brief synopsis of what's going on here before you start into the issue?
Yeah. So Marianne Williamson is a super famous spiritual teacher who has really blown up with Course in Miracles. So Course in Miracles is a channeled book. It's all about like unity consciousness and everything is God and there is no forgiveness because there is no separation. And it's very much like a loving, inclusive, accepting, we are one spiritual tome. So she's been teaching that for like decades and decades, and she gives talks on empowerment, and she's a spiritual teacher, and I think she ran for like Congress or Senate a couple of years ago.
Right.
And she's so inculcated in the spiritual community that the criticism was just like, what does this spiritual lady know about politics? Like, where is her background there? But she's really, really like conclusively known as a spiritual leader with a very clean record, you know, like no sex cult skeletons in her closet that I've heard of.
Right.
So I was on Facebook, which I am seriously considering deactivating my account. I'm really on the fence about that, even though I know
you can't really do it.
So my friend tried to do it. She ultimately did. But yeah, it's crazy how hard it is to do it, allegedly. Yeah. So, but I did see on Facebook a Theta healer, who's also like a spiritual leader, posted something of like, FYI, a friend told me that Marianne Williamson is racist and classist, just so you know. And then there was just like a slew of people who were jumping on that. And I dove in and I was like, do you have any evidence to back up this character assassination? Like, it's crazy to me how like freely people will just destroy people and slap them with these labels. So as the story was pieced together and there was this link to this blog post, the reason that Marianne Williamson is being called a racist and a classist is because she was invited to speak at a yoga conference that was being hosted by two white, heterosexual, cisgendered women who were then accused of culturally appropriating yoga from the Hindu people.
Right. Well, duh.
And then there was a blog post about this like egregious affront to Hindu people, and then everyone in the world who isn't a white cis hetero woman, how there was like negative comments on some sort of thread or post about this conference, and how the women deleted all the comments to control the narrative. Okay, so these are my thoughts on this whole thing. So all of this, because Marianne Williamson participated, this is why she's racist and classist, which my thought was like, who's virtuous enough then? Like if this person who teaches a channeled book from God on unity consciousness is not wholesome and virtuous enough to lead the nation, then who do these lefties think they're going to get?
Well, your point is very well taken. That is one of the stupidest things I've ever heard.
It's insane.
But it ignores the obvious fact that if she is classist and racist, the thing that makes her classist and racist is that she's a Democrat. Right? That would be the thing. Right. And that she believes in the political system in any way. Right. And that to me, like, that's been my, so like, I took up issue with her when she ran for Congress. It was when I was living downtown. So it must've been back in like 2012 or something like that. Right. And I couldn't understand how somebody who was so enlightened and so spiritual would think that there was any solution to our problems through politics and certainly through the Democratic Party.
Exactly.
Right? Like, so, you know, I could maybe stomach that, like, okay, because of her age, she can't quite get on with the like voluntarist or anarchist thing or whatever. So if she were running in the Green or the Libertarian or some other independent party, then I could have still, but I was like, this is something is screwed up here. Like, it almost felt like it was an attempt at that time to sort of gain a political stranglehold on the New Age community, which she tangentially is a part of, right? Even right. She's a little bit different than that because she's been on Oprah and stuff like that. She's not quite, but so that was kind of my suspicion then. But like at this point, no, like literally, so it sounds like, okay, so she is, from what I can see of all the list of 783 people who are going to run for the Democratic ticket, the two who actually don't seem like completely repulsive people, Tulsi Gabbard and Marianne Williamson, are being just mocked and smeared. And I don't know if this mocking and smearing is happening from the Democratic Party to her as well, like it is to Tulsi Gabbard, if it's just happening like in the quote unquote spiritual community.
I think at this point it's more localized than what's happening to Tulsi, because I also think like Tulsi's a more real deal threat. Like I mean, is Marianne Williamson going to really get the nomination? Right.
Well, what's interesting is these are two attractive women who have a few things about them that go against the general stances of the Democratic Party. It makes me highly question why these two want to be in the Democratic Party. You know, this idea of we're going to fix the system from inside the system to me is just like insane. But it is interesting that, like, you know, these people that they're pushing, I mean, like Elizabeth Warren and, you know, what's her name? Kristen Gillibrand. And I mean, everything is as upside down and backwards as possible, but yeah. So, okay. So now tell me, start this thing with Marianne Williamson bothers you for another reason.
Okay, so that whole thing hinged upon this issue that this blogger on Medium took with the yoga girls, and he just like shredded them. And so I took notice because the blog post was on Medium, and that's the same like blog site that hosts the piece that now comes up like third on a Google search on me that calls me a transphobic hate monger. So I'm like, so I was curious, and I read the whole long piece. And what I've noticed is that bloggers are so reckless. Bloggers didn't go to journalism school. Like, bloggers aren't beholden to journalistic ethics. They don't know what ethics are. They just know how to string sentences together, and they have a forum because that's life with the internet. So I was reading this thing, and it was like, the leap as far as like they took the comments down to control the narrative.
Right.
Like, that's all made up. That blogger doesn't know, A, that they even took the comments down. We don't know what happened to them. And she definitely doesn't know that that's the reason why she took the comments down, or they allegedly took the comments down. So when I was reading this whole blog post, I just saw the exact same tactics that the blogger who took down my gender reassignment surgery seen through the lens of the 53rd gene key article, I saw the same tactics, which was to project all this intention and to make these leaps of the logic like everyone who votes for Trump is racist. Like,
right.
Bloggers write shit like that, and then people are like, yes, that is now a fact.
Okay. So a couple of things. So first of all, for the most part, though, I'd say this, they, even journalists don't have journalistic ethics. And I think
not anymore.
Right.
Not anymore.
So that's why we're in this mess. Like, part of the reason why bloggers have this power is because there isn't a clear definition between blogging and journalism anymore, because journalism has lost its ethics, right?
Well, it started with the blogosphere. Like, back when this started, like, I mean, and granted, the New York Times has been shady for a while, but like, it's all taken quite the leap since the election. So right. I think that journal, a big, like, as far as the crass profit side of journalism, I think journalism has thrown ethics to the wayside, not just to control the narrative or whatever, but also to compete with the readership and the views and the clicks that the bloggers were getting.
Well, the other thing is that, like, you know, as far as my world, as far as like truth world here, right? Like the journalism hasn't been able to keep up, even if someone is on, like, they're not paying attention to some of this stuff, right? So in order to get some really good information, for a long time, we've had to go to bloggers or citizen journalists or independent journalists that maybe haven't been to journalism school and whatever. And some of them do great jobs. They're not doing it for clickbait. Like, you know, they're doing it because a newspaper won't hire them because a new newspaper is bought and controlled by the same people that they're trying to write an article about, right?
Right.
So this whole thing with like the failure of journalism to do its job, whether it be for ethical reasons or because just don't know reasons or control reasons or whatever, has led to this situation where like the status of bloggers rose as the status of journalists fell. So we're in this icky mess in the pool in the middle right now where right. like you now have journalists like using blogged articles as evidence for something.
Right. right.
And you have bloggers who are good. There are good bloggers who tell the truth, but nobody will believe them because they can't cite any mainstream media because the mainstream media won't tell. Right. So
right.
we have the problem at both ends here.
And 100%.
This is when we're at that space where, yeah, my friend Elisa E. always signs her emails with the quote that says that we'll know that our disinformation campaign is complete. It's from the old FBI head. We'll know our disinformation campaign is complete when everything the American people believe is a lie. We're there.
We're 100% there.
Yeah, we're there.
Yeah. So I was just sort of like breaking down the techniques of like, oh, I get why this is happening. And it was crazy to see, like, because all the people on this thread were like spiritual people.
Right.
And just like wolves and hyenas, like racing to tear this woman apart mm-hmm. based on completely projected nonsense.
Right.
So, okay. So that leads to the trans thing. Cause I'm like watching, you know, and this will tie into like how the Matrix is like revving up of just like how the Google algorithm is continuing to fuck with me and continuing to give this article more and more visibility or this blog when it's not relevant, it's not timely, it has nothing to do with anything that's going on right now, and it's this personal
and
blog.
It's not even your blog that rises to the top, it's Medium's article about your blog.
And it's not even Medium like Medium's, it's like some random person who's being hosted on Medium, because right. I contacted Medium and I was like, hey, this violates all of your guidelines. And they were like, yeah, but it's not one of our people. It's just some like rinky-dink
who comments on Medium. Right. Yeah.
Exactly. Right. And now it's like the third thing that comes up. So like, obviously the algorithm's fucking with us. So I'm paying attention to how much like the trans thing is driving the censorship machine mm-hmm. and like yep. everyone's hypersensitivity. Yep. And I was in improv class last week, and the teacher, who's a millennial, like cut a scene short. And she was like, I'm just feeling very uncomfortable right now. And, you know, I don't want us doing things that hurt people's feelings or make people uncomfortable. And of course I raised my hand and I'm like, you never stop scenes that shred Trump supporters. Like never, never, never. So whose feelings do you really want to protect here? But also listening to like the Jack Dorsey interviews, which we will get into, is like, how much of what's going on is to protect the feelings of this one small group of people? And like, it's a lovely idea. It's like a lovely, noble thing to like not want to hurt people's feelings. But I also think we're being extremely disingenuous mm-hmm. because when I see someone who has a giant Adam's apple and like big man hands and big shoulders and is wearing like a sequined mini dress and calling himself Tammy, that's cognitive dissonance in my mind. Like that looks weird to me and I don't really know what to do with it. Now that's not to say that it's okay to make that person feel like shit, but to pretend that it's not weird.
Right.
And we're all being invited to do.
Right.
isn't working. Right. And I feel like that like repression and that suppression and that like flat out faking it lie that is driving so much of the censorship and the PC stuff is just, it's off the rails at this point.
Well, there's like a huge elephant in the room. I mean, this came up, we recorded a show last night. And this came up, and you know, Randy was saying that he had that experience when he was, you know, walking to a restaurant the other day, and there was a, you know, African American trans, you know, man to woman thing who was attractive, but still weird looking, and it still took him a second to reorient his mind before he could get it together and just act normal, right?
Exactly. You know?
And that's, here's the thing, and this is what I think. People who are genuinely trans, that, and I'm not saying this as an offensive thing, but it is impossible that the amount of trans people has become so many in the last 5 years, right? Like, right. They're all part of this movement. All of a sudden, there's all these trans people. They seem to be the ones that are particularly bothered by all this stuff and sensitive about it. People who've been living trans, because there's been trans people since the beginning of time. There always has been. There always will be. End of story. Just like there will always be Nazis. There will always be gay people. There will always be racists. All that stuff has always existed, right? So the people who've been living their lives this way for all, like, they don't care about this stuff. Like, they don't want their rights violated. But, you know, just today, it's funny this stuff comes up between the interview last night and what you're talking about today. I went to, I needed to get a pedicure. So I'm just gonna say it. I'm just gonna take the chance on being real offensive. I didn't feel like going to the Vietnamese nail salon, right? Like having somebody talk about me like I wasn't there for an hour while I'm paying them to do my nails, right? Sometimes I'm down for that experience. Tonight I wasn't. So I called this, like, a salon near my work that I knew wasn't one of those, right? And to see if I could get in with a last minute appointment. They said, sure, yeah, Kim has an availability at 5:30. Great. I get there, I walk in. It's like a total white girl salon, right? Except for there's one woman sitting there without a client, and it's a Vietnamese woman. So I'm like, oh, this is hilarious. I go to the white girl. So, okay. And then when I got closer, I realized trans girl, right?
Right.
Okay. So, like, there's that moment your mind takes to register. Fine. I sat down. I got a pedicure. She was lovely. She was hilarious. She made me laugh. It was kind of the highlight of my day in a lot of ways, right? She made me laugh. We talked about, she went snowboarding last weekend. She went skiing 2 weekends ago. She plays beach volleyball every weekend. Well, all this kind of stuff. She went to, the person she went to Mammoth last weekend, woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning every day, and normal stuff, right? Right. Like, she knew that I knew she was trans, and she didn't care that I knew, and I didn't care that she knew that I knew. So, you know what I mean? And we just had normal conversation. She made me laugh. I'm going to go back to her. She did a great job on my nails, right? She doesn't care about this shit. We didn't talk about it, but I can tell you 100% for sure she gives no shits about this stuff.
Well, because she's not hyper-identified with that part of her. Like, she hasn't, like, she made whatever shifts she chose to make, and she's living her life. She didn't get stuck in, well, like,
I made the shift about it. There was, she's probably, you know, she told me she's moved here 25 years ago. So I'm going to assume, you know, she's about my age, right? So I'm going to assume she probably made the switch after she came here. Maybe not. She's from Vietnam, right? But what, at the time she did it, there was no movement. It was something she had to go through on her own. Maybe she knew a few other people from the community, but there wasn't this whole thing about it. So, like, most of the people I know, and those are people, like, in the gay community as well as trans community, who've been living their life that way for a long time, they don't like any of this stuff. Like, this is annoying to them, right? Because, you know, they did it in their own private personal way when they, you know, when they were going through whatever they were going through, and they're over it. The fact that there's this huge movement around it is getting people stuck, not just people, like, getting the people who are in the movement stuck, and it's getting people, you know, like you and I, you know, not us necessarily, people stuck because they can't acknowledge that they're feeling weird for a second and just have that moment of reorientation that is actually okay with somebody who's okay with themselves and just move on.
Exactly. Well, it's kind of like, I was thinking about this the other day, like, why is there even a gay community anymore? Like, why is that a thrill? Like, okay, I get it. In, like, the 40s or the 50s, you're like a secret club, mm-hmm. and it's a weird thing. That makes sense. But these days, like, that's such a wide swath that's your community. Like,
right. I mean, it would still, I suppose if you live in, like, some podunk town in West Virginia and there's only four of you in the entire town and you want to get together for coffee once a month or whatever, like, on some small level, I can see how that may make sense in some universe. But here, nobody, almost any place in the United States, nobody cares, and there's a lot of them. Right.
Yeah, it's weird.
And they're all different, and they all like different stuff, and have different politics, and this, that, and the other thing. So why it's like a community? I don't like any of this identity politics community. Right? I don't like any of it. It all doesn't make sense to me anymore.
But that one feels like the most outdated, like gay. Yeah. That's like half the people or whatever. Do you know, like that just doesn't, that, you're telling me what hole you prefer to penetrate. Like that, that is nothing about your beliefs or your ideologies or your values. Like that's just so weird and random. That's like my second toe is taller than my big toe. I'm a community now. Okay.
But we're, I just, so in case people who haven't listened to this before are hearing this, like, we're not saying it's out of any, like hatred. I mean, I just don't understand, like, why one wants to waste all their life having all this movement about all this stuff. Just like, be yourself, do your thing, go live your life.
Well, and for me, it's, it goes back to like being the free speech absolutist that I am, and how like that's been such a thing, and watching all of these deplatforming issues on Twitter and how many of them are trans related. And so that's why it's so weird to me. It's like this tiny group and little weird pronoun thing is shredding our First Amendment.
We talked about this last night as well, you know, like, you know, and this is something that, you know, in some, on some levels, Randy and I even disagree about, but we were able to have a good conversation about last night. Is, you know, I think that all speech is fine as long as it's not, you know, like fire in the crowded theater kind of thing, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, some people feel like, no, we have to stop people from saying these things. And, you know, I
the arrogance of someone thinking that they have to stop someone from saying something is so insane to me.
Yeah. Like, Randy doesn't necessarily think that, but Randy has a, like, and I get it. Like, I, on a certain level, I get it and have compassion or whatever. I, you know, and I don't even know if I should be
talking about it. What do you get that people shouldn't be able to say?
I get that people who have been bullied, right, in their life will feel sensitive towards it. I still think we should be able to say whatever we want to say.
Right.
I still think, yeah, like, I think part of the purpose for free speech is when somebody says something abhorrent is that you can say something back, right?
But I hate it when people tell me I'm intense. Mm-hmm. Too fucking bad. I need to learn how to deal with that. You know, like, should people not tell me what they think because that's their truth?
No, for me, I'm a free speech absolutist. Like, I think that, like, the way you counter bad ideas is with better ideas. And the way, you know, and also, if somebody's an asshole, I want to know it.
Well, it's also the only way we're going to grow our emotional intelligence. Like, if we're not allowed to have our feelings hurt, then we're not going to exercise the muscle of being able to deal with getting our feelings hurt, which is the entire iGen, which is like the disaster that we're dealing with right now.
Yeah. I got my feelings hurt all the time as a kid.
Of course.
I still get my feelings hurt.
I get my feelings hurt all day, every day, and I just work with it.
Yeah.
But I'm also like, I'm weirded out by the infantilization, and I'm not going to say it because I'm not going to get us deplatformed, but like, how come the N-word is the only word that's the N-word and we're not allowed to say? But you can say kike, and you can say wop, and you can say chink.
Right.
Do you know what I'm saying? Like, what is that? Because again, like, so many people are being deplatformed for using that word, not even in a way that's meant to be insulting, but in just like a referency kind of way. Mm-hmm. That is so crazy to me.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, I think like the fact that, you know, people are so bothered by, I mean, you know, people are so bothered by language and words, like language has, like, you know, it can be an amazing tool, but ultimately the truth is that language was put here to control us. And when we do this, when we cave into, you know, the printing press and media and stuff like that, right, that's like the controlling use of language. And when we do this, when we give in and we start asking to have our feelings protected from language, that's when it really starts to come into its finest as a mechanism of control, right?
Yeah, I don't want anyone protecting me from anything. I don't want anyone protecting me from words. I don't want the culture protecting me from, like, the male predatory gaze or whatever.
Yeah,
like,
either, yeah.
I've got my own back. Like, I don't need anyone, like, rescind other people's rights to live their lives to protect me. It's so weird.
It is weird.
It's weird. Okay. So the trans thing leads us to the atrocity that was Joe Rogan's interview with Jack Dorsey.
But I mean, it's so, it showed the world something that the world needed to see about Joe Rogan.
But here's where I have new information for you, because I know you haven't seen his interview with Sam Harris.
I find Sam Harris really tedious to listen to.
I don't understand why anyone likes him.
He's boring. He's boring, and he's just flat out wrong about almost everything.
Yeah, he doesn't. It's like he doesn't have a very sort of like awakened or interesting point of view on things. Like
his voice is obnoxious and monotone and boring. And
yeah, I get him not at all. But I was really interested in this Jack Dorsey thing because I'm really interested in the Twitter deplatforming, and I really want to know what's going on with that conversation. So obviously Joe dropped the ball, and that was the most boring, lame interview in the world. So then I listened to Sam's, which was just as shitty, and made shittier by his preamble, where he like talks about how shitty it is, but tries to spin it as though, but I think it was really good. And it was like, I didn't even have to listen to it.
He's like, it sucks, but it's really good.
Kind of. And he asked him, and he's like, I did ask him some tough questions. And he asked him like, okay, so about this deplatforming stuff, like how come Farrakhan still has an account? And Jack completely dodged the question, didn't answer it at all. You know, Joe didn't know, neither of them asked about people getting deplatformed for saying, learn to code to journalists.
Right.
And stuff like that. Like they missed all of those opportunities. So obviously I, like everyone else, was livid and like, okay, these guys are shills who are in bed with Dorsey. I also found out during this time, so I matched with this famous writer on Raya. We were trying to figure out a time to hop on the phone, and I texted, I would say now, but I just listened to the Jack Dorsey interviews on Rogan and Sam Harris, and I'm trying to talk my cortisol levels down while running a lavender bath. To which he said, oh, I just had dinner with Jack Dorsey last night. We have to talk. So I have it on concrete fact from he who will remain nameless that when he told Joe Rogan that he didn't know the details of why Alex Jones was deplatformed, that was a flat out fucking lie. Duh. But I can't even believe like that flew for 2 seconds. Like,
right.
If your corporation is going to take it upon yourself to decimate the First Amendment, you need to educate yourself on why that happened. Like, I can't even believe that Joe let that slide, but here's what I think is going on. So there was also that clip of Alex Jones accusing Joe of being CIA, which has Joe pushing back and being like, okay, now Alex is crazy because I don't work for the CIA. Mm-hmm. Right. So there's it. And so then I go back to your conversation with Robert Phoenix, where he's MK, like he doesn't know mm-hmm. that he's being controlled. And I think that is so key to this conversation. Mm-hmm. So Joe had Sam Harris on his show. Sam has no feelings or empathy. I think he must be some sort of weird sociopath or bot, mm-hmm. or I don't even know what he is.
But yeah, whereas it's Joe disturbing. Was like, it's disturbing.
It's really weird, especially for like a meditator and alleged psychonaut, which I believe none of those things.
None of that. You can't possibly have ever done mushrooms and be as bland as Sam, like, yeah.
And also be as hung up on Trump. Like, do you really not right. understand how the world works to this extent?
Yeah.
I don't get that.
Yep.
But so in that conversation, Joe was legitimately self-reflective about where he dropped the ball. I think he was totally shocked by the backlash.
Well, because he's been revealed now, so he's got to clean this up. So yeah.
Okay, so I'm coming at it like before I listened to this, I was like, yeah, he's in bed, he's sold out, he's on the payroll, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But he was calling himself out. He was like, okay, I saw where I asked him this question and he avoided it and I didn't notice it. And I noticed in your interview where you asked him this, like he was really breaking it down, and allegedly he's interviewing him again.
Okay.
So what it seemed like was that like Joe didn't realize how badly he'd flubbed it, which was kind of shocking. Like that it was such a bad interview. But my sense is that given Joe's background, as you guys said, like just like us, growing up as an athlete, spending a lot of time training and away from home, it does seem very clear that he's under mind control. And it seems like that explains a lot of what is going on. And it also seems like it would be so great if he would get that. If like mm-hmm. there was a way for him to avail himself to that information because his platform is so big, because there's all these inconsistencies in how he used to be and how he is now. And like the awareness of this interview was unexpected. I was like, how can this person, I mean, he is also an actor. So maybe it was completely acting. We can't rule that out. But also with the Jones thing, it just feels like I want it to be more in the mainstream, this MK thing. I want there to be an exploration of what is his relationship to MK Ultra, and I want him to know this.
Well, and then also by proxy, most of his audience is under a control. He is perpetrating that onto his audience, right? And they're soaking it up like pop culture, because that's what MK Ultra has become. It has gone from, you know, so you have these people who are beacons or hubs or pinpoints, right? And they're under this really direct, controlled, intense level of mind control, and then they are perpetrating it on their entire audience.
Exactly.
I can't think of anybody who is higher up in that position. Is it a higher position right now doing that than Joe Rogan? Everybody these days is paying attention to Joe Rogan. So
everyone from every realm. Like it's such an easy Venn diagram of
crossover. He is the information czar right now in a different way. So he and Jack Dorsey, right? Jack Dorsey in a different way, but in terms of podcasting, right? Like basically Joe Rogan is the information czar. And you know, this is where I'm at with it. Joe Rogan and Alex are being controlled by the same hand. This is all dog and pony show, right? So each one thinks the other is crazy and under mind control of some sort, right? Or being controlled by something or whatever.
Yes, but I think that they're not necessarily being controlled 100% of the time at the same time.
No.
But I think there are moments of self-reflective sovereignty.
I'm telling you that they have, like, I'm to the space where they're from the same program and they may have the same handler, right? And you get this puppet going, then he pulls on this puppet, then he pulls on this puppet. But when you look at the way that these folks come together is Sacred Cow Productions, I think it's called. It's Kevin Booth's company that Bill Hicks used to be part of, right? And that Joe Rogan is associated with. And Alex Jones and Bill Hicks were working at Austin Access Television at the same time. They both covered Waco. Then Bill Hicks dies and Alex Jones becomes famous. If you read the autobiography of Bill Hicks, he was developing a character that was much like Alex Jones.
I know a lot of people think Alex Jones
I don't think they're the same person, but I think Alex Jones is playing this character that Bill Hicks, you know, this is Matrix-y shit, right? This is like boo-doo-doo-doo-doo, right?
Right.
But Joe Rogan is part of that whole thing as well, right?
Yes.
I think that like pretty quickly, when they got a look at Bill Hicks, and what Kevin Booth and Bill Hicks were doing, the CIA was in on that stuff like flies on shit, and everything that went on around that, they've been controlling, and that includes Alex Jones and Joe Rogan, right?
Yes.
They come out of that same pod, right? Just like they run a certain program through gymnastics, and they run a certain program through the rave scene, they run a certain program through Hollywood, and they're running a certain program through comedy. And whether you want to believe it or not, Alex Jones is much more of a comedian than he is a journalist or a newsman or anything like that. He's actually quite funny, right?
Yeah.
If you take everything he's saying as like comedy, it's actually quite hilarious and people wouldn't be offended by it, even though it's the truth, because the truth at this point is hilarious, right?
Right.
So that's what Bill Hicks was doing. Bill Hicks was like not even really a comedian. He was just talking about what was going on and it sounded so ridiculous to everybody that it was considered comedy.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. So here's my thought about it. Because it's all like, well, how do we hack this, right? Like, where do we take it down? So given that this is Joe's audience and that he does have such a big reach and it is tied in, and again, as Robert Phoenix talked about, like to his personal experience of being fucked with as a kid, whether he knows it or not, to be able to get to Joe and to get him to see this and start to understand what happened and what is happening could be such a quick and efficient way to get the truth out to a lot of people. Because what I'm realizing, like, I've been very involved in the Twitter conversations going on about this Jack Dorsey thing, because I'm thinking, livid. So I've been jumping in on a lot of the threads and a lot of like the Weinstein threads and whatnot. And the it seems like most of the people who are tracking like the IDW people who are also free speech absolutists are in the dark of like, well, why would they do this? Why would Sam go along with Jack? Why would Jack be doing this? Why would they be taking away our rights? And I'm like, have you guys read the PNAC mission statement? Are you guys familiar with the globalist agenda? And they're in the dark about all of it. So because they don't understand that there's a larger overarching method to the madness.
There's been an intentional separation of intellectuals from conspiracy. Intentional.
We have to bridge that.
Yeah.
So, this is what I'm saying.
I want to say, since we're talking about Joe Rogan and since he did another show, and I just want to bring this up so it's on the record, and because you sent it to me, I feel like we can do it here. So I think the next person who's going to be a pivot point, and it'll be interesting to see where it goes, who's going to blow up. I mean, he's already blown up once before through his stuff with Occupy Wall Street, but he's going to blow up big now, right? And he's going to be another person used to control is Tim Pool, right? So Tim Pool was on Joe Rogan the other day, and I will say, hands down, that was the best interview I've ever heard Tim Pool give.
That was great. Fantastic.
He was fantastic. Here's my problem with Tim. That was, I agreed with almost, I'd say, 86 to 93% of what he said on.
And I also just want to say to the audience, like, I do recommend people watch it just to get an understanding of how the narrative is being constructed.
Right. He took Joe Rogan to task on some things. He disagreed. He didn't let Joe didn't even try to browbeat him. And that's by design.
I think Joe got beaten down by the backlash.
Right. But Joe was just like, I'm going to let you teach me. So right. They're putting Tim Pool in a position of authority as far as knowing what's going on. And he did, as any person who's coming out and about to be really famous has to do, and they're starring, like, you know, their thing that's going to be, he did a great job.
He
did a great job. But I've been following Tim Pool for years, and I pay attention to his videos on a daily basis. And Tim Pool is a fence sitter, which is a problem for me, but that's not my main problem with him. My problem,
fence sitter, as far as like what, left, right?
As far as like just even having an opinion on anything, right? He makes these clickbaity titles on his videos where it looks like he's going to go into something, and then he walks it back. And by the end of the thing, it's like, why did I just listen to it? You said something, and then you undid everything you said.
But is he doing that as an ethical journalist and just not taking a side and presenting the facts?
No. That is different than winding something up and then completely unwinding it.
Okay.
Right? That's because, he isn't just saying like, this is what's going on. This is one side. This is the other side. I don't know. He's basically saying, like, making it seem like he believes this, and then complete, like, I've never seen anything like it.
Is he just like mind fucking people?
Yes. Confusing. Okay. It's, and people are starting to notice it in the comments. And I don't know. I can't tell if he's doing this like intentionally on purpose from himself, or if he just like, there's part of me that feels like he wants to be taken seriously by people who are borderline mainstream, because he used to work for Vice, he used to work for Fusion, now he's doing stuff independently, he wants to have opportunities to do more stuff, so it's, you know, he wants to stay independent but have enough recognition. So I don't know if he's doing this from a place of he's being, has been really controlled up to this point, because he's worked at Vice and Fusion, and because of his breakout moment was during Occupy Wall Street, I have to wonder how he's probably being handled, whether he knows it or not, right?
Okay.
And influenced, but he's now going to look like a person of authority. And people who don't understand the stuff that you and I understand and who don't take the initiative to really research and who don't know about some of this kind of stuff are going to listen to him, and they're going to become confused. They're it's not right. So they're going to not really know. This is a disorientation campaign, in my opinion.
Okay.
And I say this, and I would say some of the same stuff about even someone like Jordan Peterson, right? Like, I like some of the work Tim Pool has done. But he has, so one of the people he's been friends with for a really long time is Luke Radowski from We Are Change, right? So he knows about all this conspiracy stuff, and he's just like, I don't like conspiracies. He's been at Occupy Wall Street. He's been at the things in Ferguson, Missouri. He's been at all the riots and shit like that. He knows that there is a conspiracy, a police state kind of, he knows the conspiracy is a real thing. He can't not.
It's crazy how, for how many people, the conspiracy is the line. It's like, they're smart. Right. They get it. They get it up until conspiracy.
He has Luke Radowski the same way Joe Rogan has Alex Jones, right?
Like,
and Luke Radowski is not as kooky and out there as Alex Jones is. Tim Pool is aware of all this stuff, and he just kind of denies its existence. And he's been in enough places now and seen enough things that for him to still be walking this center-left libertarian bullshit and acting like this conspiracy theorists are crazy and blah, 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 I just don't buy it. He's not a stupid guy. He's not stupid.
And I'm just playing devil's advocate, is it stupid or like, can he handle the larger truth?
It could be, I mean. It's
so destabilizing for people to really understand, and I'm not saying that I do, but like the levels of like nefarious plotting
right.
that are going on. I think so many people are just trying to protect a level of sanity, a level of stability, a level
or also a career.
Right.
You know, and so, you know, I don't dislike him. And this is kind of like the same way I feel about Dave Rubin and Jordan Peterson on certain levels. I like some stuff they do, but I can't, at a certain level, I'm like, you're ignoring of one like particular area over here and your cognitive dissonance on other things. Like it's irritating to me. And just the way this interview went down with Tim Pool, mm-hmm. I feel like he's being set. They really want to drive a lot of attention to him because people are going to come away being like, oh, I don't really know what's real.
I'm not saying you're wrong, mm-hmm. but I'm also noticing like, because I feel the same thing. These are people who are playing the game and mm-hmm. who are getting more mainstream success. Mm-hmm. And I just wonder, like, they don't have the balls. They don't have the integrity. Like they, you know, like they're compromising some things to mm-hmm. move forward. Is it just like how they're navigating the matrix and like getting successful? I don't know.
Yeah. So it could be that, but what I'm saying is, so Tim Pool could be just doing that, right? I'm not saying he's like some devious, nefarious character, but because of the nature of how he is and the way he does what he does, he's a perfect, like he could be a useful idiot for them on a level that like he's not even aware of.
It'll be interesting to see. Like, you're way more familiar with him than I am. That wasn't my takeaway from that interview.
No, just seeing that interview was great. Great. Right. But he has two YouTube channels, Tim Pool and Tim Cast. Go like for like 2 weeks, watch at least one video every day and then tell me about, and then we can revisit this conversation and tell me what you think.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you did mention the place, or is there anything else you want to say about this retarded Jack Dorsey thing?
Well, just, I find Jack Dorsey to be in a completely different way, but even more disturbing than Elon Musk. He's just like not even human. Like, I just yuck from the moment I started hearing his voice.
So yuck. Like frat boy, skeevy, liar, no ethics or moral compass.
And something yuck. Living That's in his beard and all that kind of stuff. And he just, like this idea that, like, you know, trying to, like, well, what we want to do is allow people to protect themselves from having to see or hear anything that they don't want to see or hear. So that's going to be the way we go about it. This padding people from reality, like it made me feel icky on the inside.
No, it's like diabolical. It's so dysfunctional. And in his interview with Sam, they saved like the last half of that god awful waste of time and energy interview talking about because they're both such serious meditators, and he just got back from his second vipassana that he went all the way to Burma to do because he's a bajillionaire and because he's like that serious about it. So I'm a vipassana meditator. The whole thing about vipassana is equanimity, right? It's just no highs, no lows, total equanimity. And during that interview, Jack said, we're not optimizing Twitter for neutrality. He actually said those words. I'm like, how can you be having this platform? A, you're not optimizing for neutrality. B, you're saying this out loud
right. So
that other people can hear you, and you're not apologizing profusely and realizing what an idiot you are for saying this / doing this.
Yeah. Yeah. Gross.
So gross.
So gross. So yeah, but you know, with the exception, I don't like care at all for Jack Dorsey or Sam Harris. Joe Rogan and Tim Pool, I would consider myself on a certain level appreciators of their work, right? So like, if I'm wrong about any of this, like I'm not trying to like do a smear or whatever, but I'm just like, guys, wake up, you're being used.
Yeah. Like I said, it'll be interesting, and I do want to check it out, and I hear what you're saying about, like, so if it's mind-fucky and what's the point of it. Yeah, and I'm just interested in this conversation because this deplatforming thing is really pissing me off. Mm-hmm. Plus this new YouTube thing where they're, like, taking down the conspiracy videos or not.
The thing that bugs me about YouTube now, like, they've changed their recommended section. Like, I can't get it to change. It's the same videos for, like, so, like, it used to be that every few hours it would show you different videos, right? It used to be every time you opened it, it would show you different ones. Then it became a few hours. Now it's like they're insisting that I watch these videos, or they're not going to show me anything else for the rest of my entire life.
Well, that's the strategy. This is how they explicitly stated they're not going to show us more truth videos.
This is how stupid it is. It isn't just about. It's not like they're just replacing the conspiracy one with some mainstream news. They're just trying to show me the same gymnastics meet that I don't want to watch over and over and over again. Right? Because I watch gymnastics on YouTube, right? I've already watched some, and they're showing me meets I've already watched over and over again.
No, I get it. Yeah, I get it. Annoying. I've already listened to the feline Liren race video 3 times. But you just said something about Tim Pool, like deliberately confusing people. You use a specific word, which is what leads us into the NASA document that I spent all day trying to find.
What word did I use?
It was like, okay, so I'm going to pull up the document where they talk about, so the document that I was looking for was this leaked NASA document called The Future Is Now Warfare Strategy document.
Was circulating big time about a year and a half ago or something.
Exactly.
Like that. Yeah.
And it talks about the plot for social disruption, societal disaffection.
I'm gonna share it so people can see.
Hold on. Upheaval caused by rapid technological changes. So
it's this document. If you guys want to look at it, you can go to stopthecrime.net /NASA.html.
Yeah, so this had caught my eye when it did start circulating a year and a half ago. And what I've noticed, like, okay, in the past couple weeks, this is in full-fledged effect. The Matrix has gotten so chaotic and so insane for no logical reason. So here are the things that happened. I've been dealing with Apple computer shit for a really long time. And they finally, like, and again, just dealing with Apple Care and all the rigmarole of getting them to fix it was, you know, its own sort of like maddening exercise in hoop jumping. So when they finally agreed after a year and 18 open cases to replace my computer, they sent me the FedEx slip to send it back. I sent the computer back. 2 days later, I get a different FedEx slip and I realize that was the wrong one and I sent my computer with the wrong one. So I called my Apple Care guy, was like, you know, can you head this off at the pass? He said, I have no way of communicating with the replacement department. How's that possible? How is there no way for them? He doesn't have their phone number. He's like, all I can do is send an email, which they didn't get for like multiple days. It's so weird to me that this like bajillion dollar corporation doesn't have it. Like, this is logical. Like, I would get it if they were some shitty startup and hadn't yet figured out, oh, we're going to need to be able to put our Apple Care supervisors in touch with the replacement department. They don't have that channel.
But if even like, if somebody like contacted you and said that, like, I like Emily's shirt, I want to know where she got it, and you like, oh, I can call, I'll just call over there and ask her.
Yeah. and it was like, and I was like, okay, like, A, that's rude enough, but B, it's the same serial number, so like, we can trust that they're going to put it together, right? It took them a week to put it together. It was just like, wow. My sense is that those departments used to be linked, because how could a company that big survive this long? I feel like they probably just unlinked them. Hmm. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, it just didn't make sense. It just created, again.
Well, none of this made, like, unless you're looking at things these days from the position of driving people nuts or trying to control them, nothing makes sense.
Yeah, nothing makes sense. So then.
The companies don't exist to service the customers. They exist to control the customers.
Right. But it's even, Okay, so this goes to my Amazon story, which is another like thing that makes no sense. So I'm changing the title of my book. I started the process of calling Amazon to see how I could do it back in January. Everyone's saying, no, you can't do it without getting a new ISBN and you'll lose your ranking. And I'm 100% of the time talking to like Patel in India, you know, yeah. Karnataka or whatever. So I'm like, I hear what you're saying, but it doesn't make sense. Like if I lose my ranking, I lose money and you lose money. Like everyone loses. It doesn't, like, it would just make more sense to let me keep my ranking because as of January, my book was number 21 in the self-help section. So we're going back and forth for multiple weeks. After 2 weeks ago, my call with them where I'm like, no, we have to find a way for me to keep the ranking. And I'm like, I'm sorry, I don't mean to be disrespectful, but I need to speak to someone in North America who understands more about rule breaking. At which point my ranking went to like something crazy like 11,000. They just straight up changed my book ranking.
Wow.
To end the conversation. That's how jacked it is, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then last week I get a call from a number in Costa Rica and a guy named Jose says, we're going to make a one-time exception for you. There's no paper trail. There's no callback number. There's no reference number. It's as sketchy can be. And as of today, my book is back to like 100 or something.
Wow.
All of this is to say, I feel like this is that NASA thing as far as just like revving up the inefficacies and like the amount of crazy hoops and things that don't make sense to create more and more societal disruption.
So it basically says here, right? So the law, like what is the part? So societal disaffection is what you're zeroing in on. Upheaval caused by rapid technological change, right?
Yes.
And of course, then there's also the protection of human electronic implants, right? That's very important.
Well, then there's the, general societal disaffection, even more rapid technology diffusion. Yeah. So that as far as just like the, how often we have to keep doing these OS updates and Facebook changing the way we do shit, like all that stuff. Yeah. And then there was that document I sent you, the New World Order plans exposed.
Yeah.
They're talking about creating a culture of a society that's forever changing so that we can never really drop in or feel rooted.
People will have to get used to the idea of change. So used to it that they'll be expecting change because nothing will be permanent. So that's like the quote, but the paragraph basically says, this often came out in the context of a society where people seem to have no roots or moorings, but would be passively willing to accept change simply because it was all they had ever known. This was sort of in contrast to generations of people up until this time, where certain things you expected to be and remain in place as reference points for your life. So change was to be brought about, change was to be anticipated and expected and accepted, no questions asked.
Right.
Yeah.
So my experience of it, and I'm curious about your experience, is that like this is now. This is here now versus this thing that as of a year and a half ago, we were waiting for to happen. It feels like, okay, we're in it.
Yeah. So yeah, we're in it. Like the New World Order is not coming. It was here a long time ago. We're not waiting for the pancake sandwich. We're not waiting for the singularity, right? It's been here for a long time. It's been here for a while. But
I love that you remembered that.
I always say, don't do anything embarrassing around me because I'll always remember. but here's the deal. So what I notice about this is people who pay really close attention to technology seem to be really bothered and affected by this. I just ignore it. And I turn my computer on and it works, right? Because I'm not engaged. Like I use my computer. I use Zoom. I watch YouTube. Like I hardly use Facebook anymore. Like I just ignore all of the updates. And so far everything works and I'm not bothered by it. But people who are actively engaged with their computers for everything they do all day, every day and need them to function in a very particular way that is above just the basic kind of thing, right? So like Randy gets really frustrated. All of his, every day, like he's a tech genius and I hardly know how to use a computer. And right. I never have any problems with mine, and he's got problems that drive him nuts all day long. So I think that, like, we're in that space now where, like, you can still not be too affected by it if you do not depend on technology in a particular way. Or, like, for old people, yes, this whole thing is disturbing. Like, you know, like my father, like he got a new TV, and the way that the cable box works with the new TV is slightly different than the old one. And every time he turns the TV off and turns it back on, it doesn't look the same as he's expecting. He thinks it's broken. He thinks the cable's not working and calls the cable company. And I just go over there and I push a button and it works, right?
So, right.
So there's that. And then there's so people who really can't use technology at all. And then the ones who really like are integrated with it, I think they're experiencing that. I think there's some people that haven't quite yet, but that's coming. That's coming. Like very shortly.
Oh, and I'm also wondering, like, how much of it is just the simulation, like, knowing for me and similar to Randy, like, oh, this is their hot button point, so we're going to keep...
Yes, the simulation still knows that my father irritates the shit out of me more than anything else, and so it just keeps pushing that button, right? And so, yes, you and Randy are more bothered by your computer, and, you know, my sister is more bothered by, you know, whatever it is. But, right. Yes, the simulation knows how to irritate, and so the way we hack it is by learning to control our endocrine system and not getting worked up, because it seems to be aware of changes in our, like, our hormones and changes in our, you know, like our nervous
system. Oh, that makes sense. It's right? Sensing those hormonal shifts. That totally makes sense.
The atmosphere is aware, and every time you breathe out, you're giving, or every time you take a piss or a shit, that's why we have sewer systems, right? You're leaving, like, the sort of imprint of all of the your inner content, right? When you breathe out, the atmosphere, think of the atmosphere as a smart environment. It's breathing it in, doing something with it, and sending something back to you. And every time you have a flare-up of your endocrine system, your hormones, your cortisol levels, or anything like that, it imprints the air you're breathing out, the piss you're peeing in the toilet, and all that kind of stuff. And there's something there that's aware, whether it's actual computer thing or whether we live in a totally aware, sentient environment. That's what it's always been. I don't know which it is, but it's in constant communication with all of that. We are technology.
That's so brilliant. Like, I want to just sit with this because it's so mind blowing. And I think you're totally right. And it's just such an interesting motivation to master one's emotional frequencies I find it so motivating these days to not give my power to the matrix. So like, and I've like taken leaps and bounds, but even just like last year, if there was like self-doubt or like scarcity consciousness, it's like that's what the matrix wants, and that was so motivating to like don't give it to the matrix. I really love this as far as emotional mastery,
right? But try this sometime when somebody hurts your feelings, instead of getting upset, thank them.
No one hurts my feelings,
right? Something like that, you know what I mean? Or when somebody does something that normally would anger you,
like, it's always thank you for the chance to learn to master myself.
Right. You know what I mean? And just start to, like, when somebody does something really piss you off, just, like, take it calmly. Okay. Right? If for no other reason, that confuses the system, but it also, your mastery, right?
Well, like, I like that it gives them no information. But Dr. K also says, do you get those black and white striped mosquito bots in the valley?
You've told me about them. I haven't seen them.
When I see those here, and like I've seen people posting, like they're not organic. I know they're not organic.
Yeah, they come from Bill Gates' little laboratory. We've had a personal conversation about it.
Okay, because I just don't want to be like boring people who are listening with it. But when I see those mosquitoes that are morning till night, it's not just like a dusk dawn water thing. They're just always here. When I see them, the amount of rage that surges through my system,
it's there to spike your endocrine system.
So this is what Dr. K said, because I asked two psychics and Dr. K about these mosquitoes, and all of them are like, no, those are not real, like those are bots. And Dr. K said they're gathering it, and so I was like, okay, so here's my question: are they injecting me with a pathogen? Or are they taking samples of me?
Taking samples from you.
They're taking samples.
They're taking samples. Like everything, right? Like people are waiting for the technology to be invasive. It's not. You let something out and it collects. Literally, I have, like, this could be a gross generalization and I could be exaggerating on a certain level, but I literally think that, like, part of the reason that we have sewage systems is so they can examine people's matter, so they can understand what's going on biologically and hormonally and understand how to affect it.
Totally makes sense.
Yeah.
Okay, so two things really quick. As the other weird simulation thing, and maybe this is the simulation picking up on where I'm at, I have not subscribed to Wired magazine in like 2 years.
Right, you stopped after that one thing that pissed you off a couple years ago.
After the election, and I like slipped out, and then I tweeted that they were CIA shills, and then I was like, I'm never going to get a self-driving car because they would take me out with one after I just tweeted that. two issues just showed up in my mailbox, right? January and February, for no reason. And I was like, okay, well, take what the universe gives me. Like, maybe there's a reason that these arrived. I started reading one and I'm like, this is really good. And then I'm like, it's gotta be a trick. Like, what is going on? And there's this whole section on the decentralized web, mm-hmm. which leads into the pocket universe conversation.
Section of the show, yes. We are now about to enter the pocket universe.
But the thought was, like, if it's so decentralized, then why is a Condé Nast magazine writing about it? Like, obviously it isn't. And then the other thing that I noticed, it's so frustrating because, like, another big part of the disinformation that I'm seeing being circulated is that it's just well written. And it bothers me to see people who've mastered their craft mm-hmm. use it for nefarious reasons mm-hmm. and fuck with people. And I read this article and it said, it was talking about, like, why going to Mars is lame and why they wouldn't do it. And it was like, you know, I'll just stay here on our dying planet. And I felt like I'd been stabbed in the stomach. And I was like, you're going to brand it that? We're actually saying that? That's a fact?
Repeat that?
It was like, I'll just stay here on our dying planet.
Okay.
And it just felt like, are we going to, it just felt like sacrilege. Like, again, mm-hmm. language, like, it ain't over. You know, like, we're still here, and it scared me so.
But saying that in a magazine that goes out to that many people is like a spell. That's spellcraft.
Exactly. So it's like millions and millions of people. So then I got, so it was like, okay, is Wired good again? No, Wired's evil again. I don't know why I'm getting it. I don't know, like, what the simulation is thinking in doing that. But it really bummed me out to read those words. And it, like, I was like, okay, I can't read this at all. Mm-hmm. But as far as the pocket universe goes, tech sovereignty, I feel like, is really, really of primary importance. Mm-hmm. And from, like, I have been asking people about it. Like, I've been asking people who's talking about privacy policy when it comes to tech, and everyone's like, that's never going to happen in the
political. Never going to happen. Go ahead.
Well, I don't want to, like, talk over you, but I did talk to some hackers about it, and they were like, it'll never happen on the internet. Like, it's not... unless we create a new internet. Everyone was just kind of like, yeah, good luck with that, hippie.
So I think that there are new internets being created with the, you know, like, the guy who created the first one is talking about creating another one that doesn't have some of the problems, but we know how this stuff goes. It'll get sold, you know, whatever. I don't know. So I do think that there will become, you know, James Corbett years ago was making a lot of shows and talking about why people in this community needed to start making mesh net communities, right? So you could have your basically your own internet with your community, right? So it was like, rather than accessing the World Wide Web, like, you have lots of documents, I have lots of documents on our computer, like, we could make a group, you know, like, it's like a small internet just for your community where you guys can share, you can communicate, you can share information, but there is not any real connection to the World Wide Web, right? So people need to start doing that in their local community.
So that's possible?
Yes, MeshNet. Go look up James Corbett on MeshNets.
But let me ask you, and again, like, I don't know, but, like, if AT&T is my Wi-Fi provider, are they tracking?
So, I don't, I'm not sure, but you can set up, I think you can set up localized kind of thing that like Wi-Fi that doesn't necessarily have to go through that. I don't know all the details. I'm not a technical person.
Like a walkie-talkie internet?
So
but you're close enough.
It's the same technology that the intelligence agencies use when they're trying to make a closed circuit system for something that they're doing.
Okay.
So it's a technology that everyone can figure out. It's not a secret technology, but it's the same, right? Like, it's... I don't want to be talking out my ass. Go check out James Corbett on MeshNets.
Okay.
But so I think that, like, that, and I do think it's going to get to a point where people can start creating on a certain level their own internets, but that's kind of far off, right? And I don't know that that's the solution. I think that one of the really big solutions is separation of your technical life from your organic life, right? Like, I love when Sonia talks about, she does this from her game self, right? As opposed to her, you know, so she has a game self.
Okay.
Her matrix.
Like an avatar?
Right. So, like, the way I think about it is, like, in, you know, the world that I would like to live in at least part-time, because I do, like, the matrix can be fun sometimes for me, right? Like, I like parties and fancy restaurants, you know, but.
But like, last time we talked, you were over them and they'd lost their pull. Are you back?
So some things in my life have changed and there are things that I appreciate more. Like, I used to use the fancy restaurants as like, that was my treat, right? Like, cause I was like bored, lonely and whatever. And so that was, you know, and that isn't so much the case anymore. So I still enjoy doing the fancy restaurants with people that I want to do it with, but like just going to fancy restaurants just for the sake of going there doesn't tickle me in the same way it used to.
Right.
Okay. So that part, parties, I still like, I just have no time to go, even though I go there and half the people there are mind controlled idiots, but I like the music. I enjoy the observation, the people watching. I love to dance. It makes me feel good.
Wait, hold up. What parties are you going to where half the people are not mind controlled idiots? Cause that's a big swath.
I go to some pretty undergroundy kind of parties, mm-hmm. right? And so when I say half, it's probably more than half that are mind controlled idiots, but there's always a few. And mm-hmm. the ones that are not mind controlled idiots, some of them don't necessarily know what's going on like you and I do, but they just haven't completely been taken over by the bullshit. They're still like semi, you know, rational and conscious and sane and, you know, like, you know, semi-organic or whatever, right?
Yeah.
So they're not totally GMO yet. Okay, so where was I going with this? So the ideal situation for myself that I would like to live in is where for a good portion of my life, like a good portion of the year or however this works, if you can live, you know, to not always live at the same place all the time, I'd like to spend a good portion of my time living in a community where, like, we don't necessarily have all of this technology in the house or the space that we live in. That
right.
The community has a place where you go when you're going to use technology that, you know, you go there, all the equipment and all that stuff is there. You don't have the Wi-Fi soup in your house. You don't have the computers in your house. So you're not being spied on and monitored and all that kind of shit. And you go there and that place has, you know, an adequate amount of security set up in terms of, you know, privacy protection and stuff like that. People, you go there, you do your work, and you leave. And you leave right. your shit there, and it isn't, you know, it's not, this is Danny's computer, and this is so-and-so, so they can't figure out. Part of this is about confusing the system, right? Like, if, you know, if you and I are doing things from the same account.
Right.
Same computer, and we're not, you know, it's kind of like going to the library. They can't really keep track of who used what, right?
I mean, I love this idea, but as like self-referential Aries rising, I'm like, doesn't work for a writer. We live in front of these things, although could conceivably have like computers that have Mac that don't have internet.
Yes.
That's what I would like. Yes. I would buy that.
Right. So, you know, people need to start separating their work computer that they do their shit on from the shit that they uploaded on, right? Like, and when you're just done, you can upload it, you know, whatever. And but maybe upload it from my computer or someone else. Like, we need to start confusing the system and
a good idea.
Right?
Trading
shit, right? Like, you go, you know, like just like when you go to the library, you can't identify who used the computer if they're just going on there and looking at something, right? So kind of like that. So you have like a tech center in your community where everybody goes and uses the same shit. You're living in a community of people that you trust. Right. So like, you know, there is, you know, people don't do all of their purchases online. So it's not about credit card security and shit like that. Right. You're just going there to use it for functions that actually serve you as opposed to like having your entire life interwoven with all of this crap, you know, and you know, so that your choice, it is an intention. I'm intending to go here and spend time working on technology in ways that better my life. And when I'm done, I'm going to go home and be a human.
Yeah, for sure. And it's like, where is that? Where, you know, we're all so spread out. We have this conversation all the time. And even on the sites that have our peers, like we are all spread out.
Mm-hmm.
and then like what locales are going to be friendly.
I mean, this may have to become like a ground thing. Just like I communicate with people in the underground to know where the party is. Like maybe there's going to have to be a hub that people who are around here in Los Angeles know this is where I can go and use that and do that. And, you know, pop in, you know, you don't schedule your appearance there. You show up when you show up, you do your thing, you leave, you know, maybe this has to become the new underground.
It has to be, because this is when Los Angeles really changed was when, you know, like I used to live at the Rodeo Grounds community in Topanga, and that was like the central gathering spot for all the freaks. And you knew you could go there and meet like-minded people. And that was around the same time that we had the Tonic Bar at Erewhon. And it was like, you could go there and learn all these truths and be with people. And like the Matrix deliberately took these places away from us so that there is no central gathering place. Right. We do need to bring that back again.
So it just like there used to be these like, you know, like certain venues you could have parties at that were bigger, right? And then the police started cracking down. So people had to start using these dilapidated warehouses, which is more fun anyway, right? And sometimes you can only use one spot one time, right? That, you know, so this, you know, or you can use, you know, you can use it for a period of time and then it becomes hot. You know what I mean? And you got to move it. So we have to, just like we, you know, do, we're willing to go to these lengths to have fun. We also have to go to these lengths to decide that we're going to take control of how technology is in our life.
But what is that? Is that snail mail?
I will go to the party when I want to go to the party, when I want to be exposed to that. I don't have it in my living room happening all the time.
No, of course. But like, if we're going underground like this for Pocket Universe, we're not going to be texting each other the address if we could, because we don't have sovereign tech.
Right.
So it goes back to like, what are we, I mean, my sense is that they're going to get rid of snail mail soon. Like, I don't think we're that the postal service, it's going to be like Amazon Corp.
Right. So I think people are going to have to become really good at reading between the lines, coded language, right? Like, you know, that kind of stuff, but also just, you know, the same way that we, you know, the same, I mean, did you work, you know, the same way that we ever communicated, like in the rave community, like there was, you know, map points and, you know, hidden clues and things like that. Right. So we're going to have to be willing, just like treasure hunts when you were a kid, you did that to have fun. We do this shit with parties to have fun. We're going to have to start being clever about the way we handle our technology.
I agree. And I also want to see a return to like 3D spaces. Like we're it's just the safest way to not be plugged in things. Like we have to get back to that. And the thing is, it's
together to talk about important shit, not just do it like this.
Right. But this goes back to the documents we were referencing. The iGen doesn't know, they don't have these skills because they've never lived in a world without that method of connection. So we have to set this up while we're still here. Because we're the only ones who have that experience.
Yeah.
Yep. So it's figuring that piece out. I had another thought, but it's on vacation.
It's pocket universe. It disappeared into the pocket universe. Okay. Anything else you want to hit before we are out of here?
No.
Okay. Well, this was a lengthy and good, interesting.
Did we go episode. Long?
Huh?
Was this a long one?
About an hour and 15 minutes.
Oh man, yeah, let's wrap.
It was good. But it was good. And it was awesome to be back doing this with you. Tell the people where they can find you.
They can find me at dannycats.com. I just uploaded my new book to Amazon. So it's in, I might be in a dead zone for the moment. Who knows?
What's the new title?
The new title is Word Up, Little Languaging Hacks for Big Change, which I love so much.
And Dani's also available for coaching sessions. And you can find me at offplanetradio.com or on Facebook at Emily Moyer. If you'd like a nutritional consultation, hit me up. Let's get her done. All right, guys. We will see you next time.
Out. Bye, guys. Thanks, Emily.
Bye.